Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anurekha Chariwag, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. I am coordinating the paper on sociology in India. Today we are going to discuss the module Kinship in India. This module has been written by Sutappa Majumdar, Research Scholar, Department of Economics, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. In this module, we are going to discuss the concepts of kinship and terminologies. We are also going to focus on kinship groups in India with special focus on the Hindus. Kinship functions in different parts of India would also be a part of this module, an evaluation of doing further studies in kinship. Objectives: 1. Holistic understanding of kinship system in India. 2. To familiarize the students with kinship terminologies and concepts. 3. To develop a perspective to understand the Indian social structure with the help of kinship and compare and contrast with the global world. Introduction. What the module aims to highlight. This module is a sincere attempt to document a holistic understanding of the kinship system in India, highlighting the concept and definitions of the kinship system as discussed by various scholars engaged in the understanding of kinship patterns in India. It becomes quite obvious that the structure of the kinship system in India would be as diverse and complex as the country, and hence it becomes a very challenging task to bring together the different perspectives of kinship. Kinship has been studied in detail by both anthropologists and sociologists, although the approach is quite different. There are two main approaches to the study of kinship system in India: Indological, which has provided a framework to understand the elements of continuity and change in the system, and anthropological, basically understanding kinship through descent and alliance. Following the same framework, this module 2 starts with a very broad understanding of the kinship terminologies associated with the kinship system, moving to how the kinship system is grouped in 4 zones: east, west, north and south, and what the specificity of the kinship structure in these 4 zones is. Moving further, the module highlights specific cases whereby, once again, the complexities and significance of the kinship system in different parts of the country is discussed. The module ends with how kinship is still important in today's time, when the institutions of family, marriage and kinship are undergoing a sea of change. This section basically brings out the new trends of kinship study. The entire module is divided into 4 main sections, and each of the sections is closely connected with others so as to maintain a steady continuity. The sections include kinship concepts and kinship terminologies, kinship groups in India, focus of kinship among Hindus, kinship functions in different parts of India, and conclusion, new directions in kinship studies. Section 1. Kinship concepts and kinship terminologies. Kinship and related concepts are interesting areas of exploration in social science research. Although kinship has been studied in detail by anthropologists and cultural studies scholars, it is quite a different scholarship as far as the study of kinship in sociology is concerned. Kinship reflects social classification and behavior along with different social patterns. Different parts of the world have different kinship terminologies and variations. Yet, very interestingly, we find several common grounds as far as the kinship structure is concerned globally. Here we are specifically going to discuss the kinship patterns in India. Now, for analytical purposes, the question we may ask is, who is a kin and how is a kin related to the kinship system? The first person implied in any kinship terms is a speaker, ego, on kinship charts. The last or the ninth person is a referent. Universally, the first and the immediate sets of kinship can be between 2 persons: man's father, woman's daughter, man's sister, etc. The exact description of other kinship positions, however, may require specification of an indefinite number of intervening relatives. These may be designated as the second, third, fourth persons of kinship terminology. In addition, kinship terms also define the biological or quasi-biological relationship between the person, essentially 3 in number: biological generation, that is, parent-child and the derivative child of my parent or sibling; 2, mating or marriage; and 3, accidentals, including decedence, divorce and adoption. Within the kinship system, each relationship may be described in terms of relative sex, and some relationships, namely those within the same generation, may be described in terms of relative age. Finally, various combination of relationships may be defined as constituting kinship sets. Each of these sets may be further subdivided through specification of the sex, relative sex or relative age of the various persons involved, argues Edmondson. Kinship systems have often been theorized as classification system and even as grammars. As a classificatory technology, kinship can be mobilized to signify not only specific kinds of connections and inclusions, but also specific kinds of disconnections and exclusions. Since relations of power are central to the articulation of such classificatory moves, kinship also speaks of the possibilities for equality, hierarchy and violence, and together define and defy other categories of relation, including genders, sexualities, races, species, machines, nature and culture. Malinowski, in his paper on kinship, opines that kinship presents several facets corresponding to the various phases or stages of its development within the life history of the individual. He believes that kinship is attached to one's life since birth and continues till the end, just like the way the word mother is uttered first and often the last word uttered. The original ties of kinship, according to Malinowski, is individual, which later develop, multiply and become largely communal, so much so that at the end the individual finds himself at the center of a complex system of multiple ties, a member of several groups, the family, always the extended household, in many communities the local group, and almost invariably the clan very often, and the tribe without any exception. Barnard and Good, while defining kinship term relationship, argue that the attributes are not fixed and the definition can include many more characteristics. It is like an open-ended checklist and further items could be added as required. Ascribed by birth and persists throughout life, initiated by marriage, explained or justified in terms of biological idiom, create expectations regarding conduct, constitute an in-group or a category in opposition to those not so assigned, involve use of relationship terms in a reciprocal systematic way, involve members of a single domestic unit or household, involve systematic enduring relationship between domestic units or household, entail joint ownership and or use and or serial inheritance of resources, serve as a medium for assigning hereditary social positions, assign responsibility for the nurture and upbringing of children, involve making presentations without expectation of immediate or direct return. Needman defines kinship as a social phenomenon which can be manifested at several different levels simultaneously. Thus, it consists of a set of ideas, a set of rules and a range of behavior, that is, it has categorical, dual and behavioral aspects. The categorical level comprises of the ways people talk and think about kinship. This is largely taken for granted and is implicit. People use its categories but cannot necessarily define them and are not required to do so in the normal course of events. The relationship terminology is the most obvious example. The dual level comprises of laws, customs, rules and values which collectively represent society's ideals about kinship. Dual rules are phrased in terms of categories, but unlike them, they are explicit, subject to disagreement and can be broken. Marriage preferences are among the most studied phenomena of this type, but all statements about what should or ought to be done are included. The behavioral level consists of what people actually do. Behavior can be looked at in two ways, collective or statistical behavior, that is marriage or divorce rates, and there is individual practice. Behavior and dual rules are interrelated in complex ways, but two points are crucial. Rules do not necessarily determine behavior and are just as likely to serve to justify it. Consequently, behavior which obeys the rules is every bit as problematic as behavior which breaks them. In defining kinship, D.N. Majumdar said, "In all societies, people are bound together in groups by various kinds of bonds. The most universal and the most basic of these bonds is that which is based on reproduction, an inherent human drive, and is called kinship. Kinship is defined as a social relationship based upon family relations. The nature of this relation can be both conjugal or affinal, that is based on marriage, and consanguinity, which is based on the ideas of blood. Kinship system is referred to as a structured system of statuses and roles and of relationship in which the kin, primary, secondary, tertiary and distant, are bound to one another by complex interlocking ties. Kinship is one of the very important institutions of the Indian family tradition. People turn to the kin for various reasons. Kinship system may also be defined as the customary system of statuses and roles that governs the behavior of people who are related to each other through marriage or descent from a common ancestor. Murdoch defines kinship system as a structured relationship in which kin are bound to one another by complex interlocking ties. The kinship terminologies may be elementary in form, that is, which cannot be reduced to other terms, derivative, which is compounded from the elementary form, descriptive in nature, which combines two or more elementary terms, and classificatory, which is applied to persons of two or more kinship categories. Kinship groups in India. It is important to recognize that there has been much interesting work on kinship among Hindus, especially on Dravidian kinship. There is dearth of sound academic work on kinship by sociologists in India. Interesting and valuable research has been done by social anthropologists. Kinship groups play a very important role in daily life rituals and social ceremonies of Hindus. In order to better understand the structure of kinship system in India, it is necessary to divide the country into four zones to understand the complexity of the kinship system. Iravati Karve, while discussing the kinship features of the Indian society, divides the country in terms of language and topographical features. North, south, east and west. To put it in a slightly different way, we can also divide the entire nation under three broad kinship groups. Indo-Aryan in the north, a subset of the Indo-European, Dravidian largely in the south, and Munda, central and eastern, affiliated with a larger Austro-Asiatic family. The Dravidian system holds a very important place as far as the study of kinship system is concerned. Various studies bring out the fact that the Dravidian system in India goes back well over 1,000 years in the written record. The Dravidian system of India is relatively resistant to changes beyond fairly simple transformations of the basic pattern. It is in fact quite conservative in its practices and functioning, so much so that the people who no longer speak Dravidian languages may not understand the kinship pattern at all. In this zone, the kinship system is a relatively a complicated structure whereby both patrilineal and patrilocal and matrilineal and matrilocal dominates the family, caste and community equally. The important features of Dravidian kinship patterns are, in a matrilineal camp, all property belongs to the woman, wife and the mother. Each clan possesses a name of some animal or plant of some other object. A person can only marry outside one's own clan. In marriages, the families exchange daughters. Marriage between children of two sisters is not permissible. In a southern family, there is no clear-cut distinction between family of birth and family of marriage. No special norms of behavior are applicable to married girls in the south. Marriage does not symbolize woman's separation from the father's house. While discussing the Dravidian kinship system, it becomes absolutely necessary to bring in the views of Dumas and Trotman, who are regarded as the most authoritative on the subject. Both of them characterize the system with reference to both categorical and the dural levels. Dumas defines the Dravidian kinship system as combination of configuration of four principles of opposition: distinction of generation, distinction of sex, distinction of kin identical with alliance relationship, and distinction of age. Moreover, the system embodies a sociological theory of marriage and supposes as well as favors the rule of marrying a cross cousin. Trotman, while defining Dravidian kinship system, includes sex, generation, relative age, crossness as important parameters. For him, the kinship system is a social organization bounded by rules, the rules of cross-cousin marriage. Contrary to this view, Anthony Good argues that there is no such thing as a Dravidian kinship system. This view of his is posited after deep engagement with the Dravidian kinship system. Through his prolonged study of the community, he concluded that there is no such thing as a Dravidian kinship system because of the following reasons. Empirically, the great majority of the Dravidian speakers in South Asia do not have a Dravidian kinship system as conventionally defined. Neither the relationship terminology nor the preferential marriage rules are in fact as they have been conventionally represented. Taxonomically, the Dravidian kinship system forms one element in an inadequately constructed typology of kinship systems. Theoretically, the notion of a kinship system leads to an overtly static analysis and involves an unacceptable degree of reification. Turning to the Indo-Aryan system of India, embracing the vast population of North India, unlike the Dravidian system, the Indo-Aryan system appears to be structured by the opposition of wife givers and wife takers, which differentiates the affine of one side from those of the other, and these are governed by the logic such that a giver of a giver is a giver and the taker of a taker is a taker, but the giver of a taker or the taker of a giver is consanguine, that is, a brother or a sister. In the northern zone, the important features of kinship organization are as follows. Kins junior are addressed by the personal names and senior to ego by the kinship term. All children are equated with one's own sibling group and all children of one's sibling group are again equated with one's own children. Principles of unity of generation is observed, that is, both great-grandfather and grandfather are given the same respect as the father. Within the same generation, older and the younger kin are kept distinct. Duties and behavior patterns of members of three generations are strictly regulated. Marriage among close kin is not permitted. The salient features of kinship organization of central India are not very different from northern India. The important features include consanguinity are the main consideration for marriage. Castes are divided into exogamous clans and arranged in a hypergamous hierarchy. The relationship between kin are governed by a custom of neota gifts, according to which cash gift is given is equal to the cash gift received. In central part of the country, cross-caste marriages is not allowed. All consanguine of Igbo generation are called brothers and sisters. Marriage alliances are nevertheless repeated, but only with one or three generations delay, that is, with more distant second or fourth cousins who are not classed as brother and sister. In Eastern India, kinship organization is different, and here there is no pattern. Mostly tribal in form, cross-cousin marriages are rarely practiced, though bride price is common. After marriage, a man lives in a separate household, detached from parental dwellings. Kinship functions in different parts of India. In the following section, we will discuss how kinship prevails and functions in different parts of the country, as argued by eminent sociologist and anthropologist, which focuses on different aspects. While Leela Dubey's work intersects kinship and gender, Madsen focuses on the notion of inequality, which is embedded within the kinship processes. Rao, who interestingly analyzes kinship within the emergence of identity, particularly ethnic identity, and finally, Dineve interlinks kinship with work and analyzes the manner in which kinship structures, acts as an experience of work and further controls and organizes not only labor but also labor process. Leela Dubey, in a paper on kinship and gender, brings out the complex interplay of gender and kinship, drawing from her own life experiences. She quite clearly discusses how the roles and functions of each and every member of the family was fixed and also quite gendered in nature. Her mother, whom she believed to be a progressive woman of her time, carried out all the duties of the mother and a wife as prescribed, but also showed a way to new ways of living and not shunning the existing system. For example, while imparting adequate training and housework to the girl children to make the girls ready for marriage, she also asserted that she wouldn't like to be too strict with her daughters about the training, as no one could confirm the fate of her daughters after their marriage. In another instance, Dubey discusses how she and her sisters were constantly reminded by their mothers not to fight over petty issues, as the time may come when they might not even get a chance to see each other post their marriage. Yet, in another instance, she discusses how her family did resist her decision of marrying a man who didn't belong to her community, Maharashtrian Brahmin, what was a Brahmin of a Hindi-speaking community. All these instances bring out the very clearly the rules of the kinship system, how one is bounded by the rules of the kinship system and also the possibility of negotiations within the kinship system. Madsen, while discussing the kinship structure in the northern parts of the country, specifically among the Jats of western Uttar Pradesh, discusses how their hypergamy stylization of the wife takers are considered superior and the wife givers as inferiors in these parts of the country. Here, the notion of equality among kinship clan pervades the whole culture and a strong sense of brotherhood prevails. The kinship clan functions both on hierarchical and egalitarian values. Rules of marriage are quite strict here. Men and women of the same clan cannot marry each other as they are thought to be brothers and sisters. The Jat community observes certain marriage prohibitions to ensure that clans and khaps remain of equal rank despite the inequality generated by marriage. Exchange of bride between families in an irreversible pattern is prohibited, as it creates an alliance based on equality based between two families. This could lead to the formation of close groups, exchanging brides among themselves, weakening loyalty to the clan. To further ensure that marriages do not result in inequalities, just adhere to the four gotra rule. This rule prohibits marriage between a boy and a girl who share any of the gotras of their father's mother and mother's mother. The Jat kinship has a certain internal consistency. The marriage prohibitions are mechanisms to regulate marriages to ensure inter alia clan equality by putting a brake on both exchange marriages, which may lead to the formation of closely related elite clans, and on repetitive unidirectional marriages, which may create a hierarchical system of hypergamous clans. While discussing the kinship ties among the Santhal community in a village called Chaupura in Dumka district, Jharkhand, India, Nitya Rao discusses the processes by which kinship relations, particularly patrilineages, are being strengthened amongst the Santhal community in the village. Here, the kinship relations are being reformulated in the context of the struggle for a separate state of Jharkhand, emphasizing on the tribal and Adivasi identity. Kinship operates here in gendered ways and distributing resources and organizing work, time and space. Women here for the first time ever demanded for universal land rights, which was bestowed on them in the year 1996, amidst lot of chaos and conflict. Kinship in this community transmits both identity and resources. Kin groups have played an important role in legitimizing access to land and ensuring social agreement. Women have come in the forefront to protect their rights and are actively engaging with external state sources of legitimacy. Dee Navy, in the paper on kinship and its morality in an urban industry in Tamil Nadu, discusses the role of kinship and kin morality in context of work. The paper focuses on the ambivalent nature of the kin morality when mobilized outside the household and the family. Ethnographic evidence shows how employers frequently invoke the morality of kinship and caste in an attempt to secure a reliable and compliant labor force and to avoid overt class confrontation. However, employers' efforts to promote kinship, real or fictive, and its morality in the workplace appear inadequate in the face of high labor turnover and frequently collapsing employee-worker relationship in small-scale industries. While employers' repeated use of kin ideology succeeds in silencing the workers on the shop floor, it is much less effective in securing a stable labor force in the long run. The argument put forward in the paper points out to the limitations of kin morality and questions its effectiveness in informal context of labor employment. The discussions shed new light on the role of caste and kinship in recruiting, retaining and disciplining labor in India's informal economy. New direction to kinship studies. In looking at emerging trends in the kinship and kinship studies, it can be said that there is a trend towards the transformations of analytic concepts of kinship. Kinship at present times is constructed in diverse fashion and usage of kinship is widespread and not merely restricted to family, marriage, clan and caste. The broader definition of kinship system entails transnational, transcultural and cross-border meaning and practices. Drawing from the argument of Mackinnon and Franklin, kinship now has moved beyond biology and perceived as a natural fact to a more complex interplay of surrogacy, egg donation, assisted conception and cloning. Kinship is also understood in the context of genetic counseling, the Human Genome Diversity Project and biomedicine. Further, kinship is also examined through photography, computerized artificial life modeling and claims to knowledge as intellectual property. While examining the historical and contemporary entanglements of the cultural meanings of blood, seed, lineage and evolutionary inheritance and the ways in which these are mobilized to create an exclusion, an urgency is felt for new understanding of the kinship pattern. After discussion in this module about kinship in Indian practices, we see that one of the important aspects is there has been a dearth of study among sociologists on the kinship patterns in India. Till now, we have a lot of work on family in India, on the marriage practices in India. But recently, we have been drawing still upon the work of Iravati Karve, later on Leela Dubey, and also recently Kamala Ganesh. We also need to be aware that we need to understand kinship not only in terms of its new ways in understanding, especially in terms of the way that medicine and especially science and technology has intervened within reproductive choices of the people. Thank you.